Thanks, Greg. I'm not even going to touch that point because seeing what other people have had issues with that, I'm just going to stay away from it. So yeah, I'm a wildlife health specialist with Parks Canada based out of the Western College of Vet Medicine here in Saskatoon. Been here about, in this job for about 13 years. And now an associate with the CWHC. Also adjunct at the vet college at WCBM as well. So those are sort of the three different hats that I wear. And whoops, that's not the one I wanted.
What point?
Interesting how that happened. How about we just start that again? Seemed to go right to the end. I'd rather start at the beginning. How's that? So my talk is going to be very much kind of blue sky is what I call it. Looking at fairly high level views of threats to wildlife health and One Health, but how those are related to specifically to wildlife conservation in Canada, but also worldwide. So a lot of my thoughts are going to be my own sort of personal ramblings, and a lot of them are going to come from the left hand side of the screen there, so out of left field. So just warning you now. Okay, I'm obviously doing this wrong. Let's try it there. That's better. Okay, so if you look at the IUCN Red List Index, if you look at mammals, amphibians, and different taxon, over time, in the last 40 to 50 years, most of these taxons are declining quite rapidly, especially if you're a coral. In a marine environment. That's obviously, there's been a strong decline in the last few decades. And you look at things like the World Wildlife Fund, it has a Living Planet Index. There's been a big loss of biodiversity in the last 40 to 50 years. And that trend's very likely to continue. I don't think we're gonna stop that completely. But it really depends which taxon you're looking at. So if you look at the effect of disease on some of these impacts on these different taxa. On amphibians, diseases have a relatively large impact, but some of the other taxa, like mammals, terrestrial mammals, and things like that, it's mostly driven by habitat loss and degradation. So those are where some of the larger threats are. They're not specifically disease, but they're causing big threats to biodiversity loss around the world, if you look at a global scale. So this is looking at a very big picture. Okay, the end key is just too tempting for me to hit. Maybe I should go to this. There we go. So if you look at current threats to disease emergence in wildlife around the world, there's a recent paper that came out on global change, parasite transmission, and disease control. It's the things we all have heard about. Most of the ecosystem stressors are human caused due to human population growth and industrialization. Climate change would be the top of the list. Pollution, habitat loss, fragmentation, these are the big drivers of biodiversity loss, but they're also the big drivers of disease emergence, both for wildlife disease and zoonotic disease. Host dancing, farming intensification, so they're pretty big issues like that. These folks modeled the stressors and the effects they cause on a sort of a global scale, how we might sort of mitigate those. They're difficult issues to deal with, and it's difficult to get people interested in them because these things also cause socioeconomic effects for humans around the world as well. There, I managed to do it without going to the end. Thank you. Thank you. Hold your applause till later. There was a paper that came out in 2000 by Peter Daszak and a couple of other co-authors that looked at relationships between emerging infectious diseases between wildlife, humans, and domestic animals. And speakers after me are going to talk about the two bottom ones there, the human and domestic animal emerging infectious diseases, but they're all very closely interlinked. But a lot of the sort of emerging infectious diseases that we're finding lately are having big impacts on wildlife only, and maybe not spilling over into humans or not spilling over into domestic animals. So white-nosed syndrome, for example, is one of the the ones that jumps to mind right away. It had a huge impact on little brown bat populations in North America. It will have some effects on human health over time if it goes on at the rate it's going right now. But they also looked at a companion paper, and they sort of looked at what's changed. And this is why we've been cited as sort of a model of One Health around the world. So they recently released a sort of companion paper looking at One Health and emerging infectious diseases in wildlife. What kind of progress have we made in the last 2 decades? And it's a really interesting read. And they sort of conclude that despite improved knowledge of the underlying causes, little's been done on a policy level to sort of address some of these threats that I mentioned. And for the sake of public health and well-being, humankind really needs to do a better job of conserving nature and preserving the ecosystem services that those species provide, including disease regulation that biodiversity provides, while also understanding and mitigating activities which lead to disease emergence. So we sort of done a good job at, you know, understanding some of the factors that lead to disease emergence in wildlife. But we really haven't developed the policy areas, you know, on how we're going to deal with these. How do we stop the spread of white noise syndrome, for example? We haven't found good ways of sort of preventing those things, or even, you know, predicting which the next wildlife disease is going to be, even though we spent quite a bit of money looking for those. And they also make the point that it's probably cheaper in the long run to spend your money on mitigation beforehand and prevention than trying to deal with these diseases once they emerge, either in humans, domestic animals, or wildlife. It's much more difficult to control them sort of post-emergence, and that your money would be better spent in sort of mitigation beforehand, and much like Craig was mentioning earlier. So if we look at some of these, you know, current threats from biodiversity loss, clearly in the amphibian world, one of the biggest ones is due to chytrid fungus. It's had huge impacts on amphibian populations around the world, and now we've got the more recent example of the one affecting salamanders in Europe primarily, and Asia. But will there be other, you know, sort of Batrachochytrium fungi that are going to be affecting other taxa in the future? We don't know. It's a bit of a crapshoot, but clearly I think that's the one that's had the biggest conservation impact in the last sort of 20 to 30 years. The other one that I would say that is the biggest current threat in North America is probably white noise syndrome. It's having very large ecosystem level impacts on bat populations, which will likely affect things like insect regulation over time. And there's likely going to be other fungal agents in the future that we haven't thought of yet, or that are going to emerge in the next sort of 25 years. So I think that's where that sort of scanning surveillance that Doug was talking about this morning becomes very important. We need to, I guess, have the ability to pick up those types of new disease emergence that have potential to affect biodiversity at a very large sort of continental scale, pick them up early, and allow some sort of mitigation to happen if possible. And then the other one would be snake fungal disease, but that one's very different. And I would encourage people to maybe have a look at the latest CWHC document that looked at the potential threat of snake fungal disease, because there's so many unknowns around what are the population impacts of that particular disease going to be in North America and here in Canada, and how much money should we invest in that? Because the population impacts, there's so much uncertainty around it that we really don't know whether, you know, there are going to be massive population impacts, or very slight, or none at all. For some species, it's probably going to be significant. For others, it's probably not going to be a big deal at all. But that's where the population effects and mitigations going forward are very unclear. So that's probably where we need to invest more money in monitoring over time in different populations and different circumstances to find out what those population effects are going to be. And those might take 10 or 20 years to figure out. It might take a long time. But that's, you know, one example, I think, where there's certainly potential for some pretty significant biodiversity loss with that particular agent. I've done it again, maybe just. Repetition is good, I find. destroy that one. So, and then if you look at some invasive species, there's certainly some factors out there, which I think should be part of the Canadian Wildlife Health Cooperative purview in terms of looking at wildlife health. Those things like feral cats, I'm going to talk about that example specifically in another slide. Feral pigs and wild boar are certainly an issue in the US. They're starting to become an issue in Canada, but again, the effects of wild boar and increasing wild boar populations here in Western Canada are really unclear. We really don't know whether they present a large disease threat or whether they are going to present a threat to habitat disruption to other species. They're very unclear at this point. And then other things like zebra and quagga mussel obviously have the ecosystem impacts in the Great Lakes region and now are starting to spread west. Things like whirling disease as well, other invasive aquatics. I think those things, which are not necessarily diseases, invasive species, are having just as big or more impact than some of the diseases we're looking at, and I think deserve attention as well. So I wanted to bring up the example of feral cats, because something I've been looking into recently, just to you know, get my own education on this issue, because it is one of those sort of contentious issues, depending who you talk to, whether you're a cat person or a wildlife person, maybe you're in the middle. But I came across this paper in 2013 that looked at the, you know, roughly, if you wanted to estimate how many wild birds are being killed by feral cats or pet cats in North America, they did a pretty good job of estimating, and it's somewhere between about 100 and 400 million birds, roughly, in Canada. And it's about an order of magnitude higher in the US. It's as high as sort of 1 to 4 billion, depending on which estimate you look at. So with a lot of these migratory species, they're sort of getting killed in their breeding grounds in Canada, but also in their wintering grounds, wherever they happen to be wintering as well. So it's kind of a double whammy there as well. So that's a fairly large number of cats. The one paper estimated being anywhere from about 2 to 7% of bird populations in southern Canada would be getting killed annually. So that's fairly significant. That's a lot of birds and a pretty significant source of mortality. And if they looked at another companion paper that sort of compared loss to cats. So the one on the far left there on that red graph is the bird loss due to cats. And then they've got sort of wind farms, running in the windows, power lines, all that kind of thing. They're all much lower, and this is a log scale, so keep that in mind. So that's a big wildlife health issue. I think that should cause a fair bit of concern for people who are interested in retaining biodiversity. But finding mitigations against that is very challenging, because then you sort of pit one species against another. And this conversation is going on all over the world, but I think the Canadian Wildlife Health Cooperative is very uniquely positioned to provide, you know, very good solid data on maybe how many feral cats are out there, what species are they killing, are they having population impacts. So not necessarily a disease issue, but certainly a wildlife health issue, I think, from my perspective. So if you look at future threats, so, you know, really big picture, sort of peering into the crystal ball, in the future, in the next 25 years, it's climate change, really. That is the big numero uno threat, I think, that we are going to be dealing with and all talking about in the next 25 years of the Canadian Wildlife Health Cooperative. And we have to find ways to adapt to climate change. The finding mitigations are really going to depend on the severity and where they occur and what sort of local context. Not all of those detrimental impacts from climate change are going to be disease mediated. A lot of them, species will be prey and host switching. Parasites will be host switching on a very large sort of continental massive scale. So we need to be able to find resilient ways of dealing with that, and I'll talk about that. But it seems to me, if I'm looking forward into the future, that is going to be the one thing we are still always going to be talking about for the not just the next 25 years, the next 50 years or longer. The other one, I think, which I haven't heard a lot of discussion, not certainly in the wildlife health realm, is water. A lot of people are predicting that, you know, we're going to fight the next wars certainly in other parts of the world, maybe not here in North America, but they're going to be fought over water in the sort of next 3 to 5 decades. So people are going to be proposing things like large-scale water diversion. What's going to be the ecosystem impact of that? How many people are going to be considering wildlife health in that? So I think CWHC in particular, again, can be a voice sort of pressing for people to consider those effects, because most people are going to just begin looking at the effects on humans in terms of public health, maybe looking at the effects on livestock health and that kind of thing. But the CCWHC or the CWHC is uniquely positioned, I think, to sort of be that voice for wildlife when it comes to wildlife health. And there's probably crazy things we haven't even thought of yet that people are going to be proposing to sort of keep water going into the Ogallala Aquifer in California so we can all eat strawberries in the winter. So I don't even know what they are yet, but those are things I think we're going to be dealing with. And then, you know, sort of mass translocation of wildlife if water is diverted. It seems to me that that is going to be need to be discussed in fairly large detail in the coming years. And I think we have to admit that, you know, this, a lot of people say we're in a sort of sixth extinction event worldwide, era we call the Anthropocene, where most of the extinction are being caused by man-made changes. You know, we have to start making very significant trade-offs. Are we going to start protecting species or habitats? Because we're not going to be able to do it all. We're going to have to start prioritizing somehow. So some things we're not going to be able to save. We may have to just say, look, we're going to be able to save this chunk of habitat, but that may not be good for species X or species Y. And I think there are going to be a lot of trade-offs in the future. So there are a lot of climate conversations taking place, certainly within the federal government, looking at sort of it's certainly a key priority of this current government that we have right now. And within my agency, we're looking at all these sort of different functions, but a lot of, you know, impacts on infrastructure, how we're going to pay for that in the future. You know, how are we going to be sustainable as an organization? What's our contribution going to be to reducing greenhouse gases? And then also linking in with provinces and territories and all those other people as well. But one of the big things we're doing right now is looking at climate change vulnerability assessment. And Craig mentioned this in his first talk this morning. And I think that provides us a bit of an opportunity in the future to look at wildlife health vulnerability assessment, or including wildlife health in any sort of vulnerability assessment that is talking about climate change. So, you know, what is going to be the effect on wildlife health of you know, a 4-degree increase in temperature or a decrease in precipitation? And it's going to be very regionally divided across the country. It's going to be, so we've started going park by park and actually looking at different regions of the country, doing these vulnerability assessments and looking at potential effects of climate change in the future, how we might adapt and mitigate those. So the question that Patrick put forward when he put forward this agenda was, how do we respond to all this? So one of the ways that sort of the international community has decided to look at reducing losses due to biodiversity is looking at this sort of Canada Target 1. So that was a target that looks at protecting 17% of our terrestrial areas by 2020 and at least 10% of our marine and coastal areas. We're making progress towards that, but there's a lot more work that has to be done, especially if these, you know, changes which are being predicted for climate change are actually going to be at the extreme upper end of the range. So that's one thing that's being discussed in my agency at quite a high level right now. But I think one of the ways the Wildlife Health Cooperative community can respond is through having these robust, resilient networks. Just through information sharing and data sharing and making sure that everybody is aware of what everybody else is doing. I think, you know, I really believe that having effective One Health intelligence will help us mitigate against some of these coming changes much better than we have in the past. And I think a really big thing for me personally is just keeping wildlife in the public consciousness. Like Craig mentioned this morning, people in downtown Toronto, Montreal, Vancouver have really lost that link with wildlife and wildlife. top spaces to a large degree. And it's really hard to convince most of the Canadian general public that they should be spending huge amounts of tax dollars on wildlife, just for wildlife's sake, just for wildlife conservation. So unless you can make that link to public health or domestic animal health, it's a really difficult sell sometimes. So I think one of the things that the CWHC can really do is keep that, you know, sort of wildlife health message out there in front of the public and show the Canadian public that they do value wildlife. Because every survey we do of Canadians, we find that, you know, there's a certain percentage of the population that really does value wildlife, but there's also a significant portion that does not and doesn't really think about it on a daily basis. So I think if we don't keep sort of wildlife, you know, at the top of people's minds, there eventually we'll get some public disengagement, and that will result in public apathy and reduced resources over time. So it seems to me that that's our role that the CWHC can play. And I think we also have to broaden our areas of expertise. It seems to me that, you know, one of the things I think that we see a need for in the future is risk assessments that incorporate economic analyses. If we show people what sort of economic impact we can have by some of these mitigations in the future, both social and economic, I think it's a much better sell to people over time. So I think if we can incorporate that type of thinking into the organization, and also social license is becoming more important, I think, over time, and the social sciences. So maybe we have to look at incorporating some of that expertise within the COHC so we can understand why people behave the way they do or why we might want to change people's thinking on a certain topic. I think that's going to become much more important in the next 25 years. And like I mentioned earlier, I think mitigation strategies in the long term will be much cheaper than trying to chase diseases and do post-emergence control. So, you've seen this slide before, several times. Now I'll actually talk about it. I suspect that, you know, that the next 25 years of the CWHC in terms of wildlife conservation is likely to be as challenging or more challenging than the first 25 years were, for a variety of reasons. And I think, you know, keeping wildlife conservation in the public imagination and showing people what the value of investing in wildlife conservation is will be really critical to achieving successful wildlife outcomes over time. So I don't think it's going to be all about just about surveillance. It's going to be about communicating that message to the public and the importance of why we're doing this. And I think the changes are going to be more rapid over time. So it's going to require very innovative thinking. And I really do think the Canadian Wildlife Health Cooperative is a Canadian institution worth celebrating. I mean, there are other countries that have adopted this model now. And it's I think, quite fitting that we're having this meeting in Saskatoon, in Saskatchewan. The provincial logo is down at the right there, lower right. And as you can see, it's topped by a beaver with a crown. You know, it's a great logo. But the Latin at the bottom is Multis Gentibus Viris, so from many people's strength. And I think that is the strength of the Wildlife Health Cooperative, is that you've got lots of different people from different backgrounds, different fields, that contribute health intelligence to improve wildlife health for Canadians. And I think if you keep that in mind, I think wildlife will win, and Canadian society will win as well. So those are my sort of thoughts and ramblings. And if anybody has any statements or comments or questions, I'd be happy to listen. Thank you.